Hello and welcome to this Water Research Foundation webcast. The title of today's webcast is Customer Communications During Drought. My name is John Albert and I'll be the moderator for today's webcast. This webcast is the latest, the last of a four-part series that the Water Research Foundation has done to address sustainable drought management and communications that can help and be applied to a variety of needs and drought conditions utilities may face. I'm showing here the webcast series, and it was designed to serve as a forum for utilities to share best practices and lessons learned through past experiences. The current drought in the western U.S. serves as a live case study, and for each segment of the webcast series, we have experts walk through their insights and provide guidance relevant to any utilities experiencing drought or utilities who want to be prepared for potential drought in their regions. Here's a listing of the webcast series. Each webcast, including this one, will be archived for future viewing on the WRF website, and there's the address there down below. We have three great speakers with us today, Jesse Saish, Luis Generoso, and Jeff Terrell. Jesse Saish is the Public Information Officer for El Dorado Irrigation District, EID, a special district located in Placerville, California. EID serves 2,200 square mile service area in the Sierra Nevada foothills between Sacramento and Lake Tahoe. He manages EID's Communication and Community Relations Department. He has also worked in public information and outreach positions at the district since April of 2006. He holds a bachelor's degree in English from the University of California, Davis, a master's degree in Russian and European studies from the University of Kansas, and has studied public management and administration at the graduate level at the University of Nebraska, Omaha. Our next speaker, Luis Generoso, is the Water Resource Manager for the City of San Diego Public Utilities Department and is in charge of San Diego's Water Conservation Program. He has worked for the city's Water Conservation Program since 1991 and has took over as Program Manager in late 1997. The San Diego's Water Conservation Program reduces water demand through promoting or providing incentives for the installation of hardware that provides permanent water savings and by providing services and information to help San Diegans make better decisions about the water they use. Luis is co-chair of the San Diego Water Conservation Action Committee, the city's representative to the Water Conservation Gardens Joint Powers Authority, editorial advisory board member of the Water Efficiency Publication, member of the California Urban Water Conservation Council's Education Committee, member of the California Urban Water Agency's Water Use Efficiency Committee, member of the California Department of Water Resources Urban Stakeholder Committee, and past liaison to the San Diego Community Forest Advisory Board, where he worked on San Diego's Community Forest Initiative. And our last speaker is Jeff Terrell. He is the manager of the conservation at Denver Water. He has over 15 years of training and experience in water conservation, drought-tolerant landscaping, public policy making, and has survived two droughts and looking forward to being ready for the next drought. Denver Water has an internationally recognized conservation program, which we'll hear about today, which provides opportunities for over a million customers to use only what they need. Jeff has a BS in natural resource management, specializing in community involvement processes from the University of Nebraska, and is working on a master's of urban and regional planning at the University of Colorado Denver, focused on land use and resource management. Before we begin, I'd like to make some logistical announcements. Today's webcast will last 90 minutes in total, and the webcast will be recorded, as I mentioned earlier. The recording and the PowerPoint slides will be posted on the WaterRF website within 24 hours. At any time during the presentation, you'll be able to send us questions using the question box on the lower left hand of your screen. Please feel free to submit questions at any point during the webcast, However, we will wait until the end of the webcast to answer your questions. Immediately following the webinar, you will be directed to follow up with a survey. Please take a moment to answer these questions. They really help us ensure that our webcasts are the resources that you need. Finally, I'd like to highlight a couple WaterRF reports that may help in customer communications. The first one, Customer Behavior and Effective Communication, 4012, investigated residential customer behavior relating to water so that water utilities can develop appropriate water conservation communication tools and strategies to reduce residential customer water consumption. The effective communication tools, strategies, and messages on water use and conservation behavior were studied within this project. Second, as a workshop series titled the Urban Water Demand Roundtable, which is developed by the Decision Center for Desert Cities at Arizona State. It's designed to help professionals and academics engage in water demand research to share their leading results. Part of the funding comes from the Water Research Foundation. The themes in 2015 roundtable were water demand, human behavior, and outdoor water demand. Links to these presentations from 2013 and 2015 can be found on the WaterRF website as well. And finally, drought management in a changing climate, using cost-benefit analysis to assist drinking water utilities, Project 4546. The project helps water customer boards, boards of governance, and stakeholders better understand the total possible costs of drought and improve acceptance of drought planning and mitigation measures to minimize the cost. Project findings are also helpful to the greater scientific community in tackling fundamental questions on the application of cost-benefit tools. In addition to the report, an example cost-benefit analysis is available to download from the project resource section of the project page located on the WaterRF website. With that, I'm going to turn the talk over to our first speaker, Jesse Sage.
Thank you. Thank you, John. I'm really excited to participate in this webinar, especially in the context of our other speakers as well. As you'll see as I go through my my presentation, I work at a very small water district in Northern California, so I think the context is good with the other speakers. I think this is a picture that we all know pretty well. Of course, the drought is significant in the entire western portion of the United States, but California especially so. And as you can see, we have just 100% is either moderate drought or above. My service area is in the exceptional drought area. This picture shows where El Dorado County is. Our service area goes from the Sacramento County line to a little further into the foothills, and we cover about 220 square miles of variable terrain. We serve just over 100,000 people, and our water, our drinking water system, has a little over 40,000 service accounts. So it's not a large customer base, but it is fairly large and complex geographically. Before we really talk about drought, obviously this is what everybody's thinking about. And especially what we think about our water sources are surface water. We do not have any groundwater. So you can see in this slide I've had a message saying the slides are not advancing. Okay. So as you can see, between 2011 water year and 2015, the trend is going down. That's very clear, but worth pointing out. Now, the difference for El Dorado Irrigation District is we have a fairly solid portfolio of water rights. We have facilities and water rights that that date back to the 1850s. So, as you can see in the slide, our water supply includes a certain amount from Folsom Lake. We have a Project 184 federal hydroelectric project, and we have our primary drinking water reservoir, Sly Park. It has over 21,000. So you're looking at a total of 48,000, a little over 48,000 acre feet of water. Water demand for 2014, a drought year, was 29,000 acre feet. That meant we had a surplus of 19,000, over 19,000 acre feet. So this has been the drought in California is very much a statewide thing. On a local level, the picture can be a little bit more complex. The State Water Resources Control Board put us into the Tier 7, so we're required to meet a 28% conservation standard. We're required to produce these reports monthly. Under a 28% conservation goal, we're prohibited. The State Board regulations prohibit irrigation of ornamental turf on public street medians with potable water, outside irrigation for newly constructed homes and buildings, using potable water to wash sidewalks and driveways, using hoses without shut-off nozzles, and so forth. So EID's drought response, shortly after the governor declared a drought, our district declared a drought in February of 2014. At the same time, we also have a separate water system that serves a very small population in a community called Outingdale, and that was immediately put into a stage 4 water emergency because the water source was a post-1914 right that was curtailed. In the main system, our customers achieved a voluntary 24% conservation. This was we felt this was an exceptional result. After April 1st executive order mandating a 25% water use reduction, we were then placed into the 28% tier. Our first month of reporting, our conservation totals had us at 32% for June. And while the official numbers for July have not come out yet, I understand they will be 32% or higher, where our customers are doing a very good job. This is helped by mandatory watering restrictions that we have in place. So once a week watering is allowed from November 16th through April 15th, and it depends on the ending number of customer addresses. Twice a week is through from April 16th to May 31st, and the time period we're in now, the broad summer period, is three times a week watering. Drought outreach for EID has been fairly straightforward. I should say that we had at the beginning of this drought three members of staff dedicated to this. That went down to two, and now it resides solely with myself. So we're a very small operation here. So news releases, direct customer postcards, alerting folks to the changes in water schedules, and so forth. We have a bi-monthly water waterfront customer newsletter that we typically fill full of drought-related messaging. We have door hanger notifications and conservation tips, and of course we have an ongoing water waste prohibition that we let our customers know about. We also provide restaurant water conservation table tent cards and posters. A picture of some of those things. The waterfront is our customer newsletter. We have a drought page on Facebook as well. So that drought webpage includes a fair number of resources that we use to get the messages out. We've sent out letters to the top 10% water users urging conservation. That probably would go under the heading of challenge going forward. A lot of folks didn't respond well to that. Water efficiency survey. We offer this to customers complimentary, where a water efficiency technician comes out and has a look at their irrigation systems and suggests ways in which they can cut water use. We attended over 50 community presentations, media interviews, during the early summer months of 2014, we had electronic street signs at busy intersections. We also had movie trailers shown prior to feature films. Again, this was 2014. This year, I'll talk about this a little bit later, but this year we haven't needed to do some of these things because the drought messaging has matured. So folks understand a lot more, and now that we've had a little bit of time and experience under our belts. We participated in regional drought committees. We have a modest rebate program, and we engaged in the Water Smart in a Water Smart pilot program with 12,000 customers, but we chose not to renew that due to our low customer usage of that tool. We provide outreach to local schools and drought messaging in newspapers. This shows just a couple of those things. This shows a postcard that went out alerting folks to the updated watering restrictions 3 days a week through September 30th. So looking sort of from 2014 to 2015, we continue with the postcards, the tent cards. Our web content is refreshed weekly. We track conservation progress on a weekly basis compared to the 2013 base year. We also provide the monthly and a year-to-date number as well. We also use social media. We have a drought information Facebook page. And I've had interviews with regional television. Estimated costs, we spent approximately $75,000 in 2014. This doesn't count the Water Smart pilot program. We expect to spend a bit less by the end of 2015, approximately $50,000 to $60,000. This doesn't include the Outingdale trucking costs. So this year, our Outingdale community, which went to a stage 4 water emergency, the water was completely curtailed, so we have been trucking water from our main system to the satellite system on a weekly basis, and that costs us a fair amount. So some of the challenges to implementation. With reduced water sales, of course, you have a hit to your budget. Our financial plan helped offset that water revenue loss, however. Drought surcharges were not implemented. Our board was very intent on using education first before we would ever get to a punitive action, and it's worked so far. And like I said, our rate structure helps. Our rates are based on a 50% fixed charge and a 50% variable charge. So this sort of helps out when there are lower water sales. We also run a hydroelectric project, and of course the amount of revenue we've received through that has gone down, but that helps as well. And we are in the beneficial and somewhat strange position to transfer water as well, a relatively small amount to a district in Central California. So what do we offer? We basically offer a home water survey, a very modest $100 rebate on qualifying efficiency products. These could be low-flow toilets, high-efficiency washing machines, weather-based irrigation controllers, irrigation efficiency upgrades, hot water recirculating pumps. We offer free plumbing retrofit kits, shower heads, toilet tank banks, bags, toilet flappers, bathroom and kitchen aerators, and toilet leak detection packets. We offer a number of tips and tools on our website, on eid.org/drought. There are especially many very good resources from the Save Our Water campaign. This campaign offers many ready-to-use social media, newsletter articles, and this has been very helpful, especially for such a small agency as ours, with as few internal resources. A recent change we've added to our bill, and this may not be terribly clear on your screen, but we added usage in gallons. We found that we bill in cubic feet, of course, but that doesn't mean a whole lot to customers. And gallons per day gives folks a better idea of what they're using, especially when our flyers and sheets give ideas how many gallons you can save. So this gives them something to look at and say, okay, that's what I need to do. Water waste enforcement. Our board was intent on education, and we've taken that to the extreme. We're incredibly positive in our messaging, and our customers have really stepped up. So we offer ways to report water waste. Folks can call customer service in the office. They can email our water efficiency group, and we have an online form. Our field staff carry water waste tags that are essentially a friendly reminder. We may have noticed that your sprinklers are overspraying, or water's going to the gutter. Things like this, and the vast majority of the time, folks have really responded well to that. Maybe they didn't even know their system was set in such a way. So customer feedback has been positive. We've engaged a temporary employee to perform water waste patrols, and that employee has had extremely, extremely good feedback from the folks he's interacted with. So as of July 1st, we've had 233 reports of water waste, issued 135 water waste tags, and issued no fines whatsoever. And our intention is not to fine anyone, and we've not needed to so far. Folks are really responding. Just a picture of that water waste tag, and we have a prohibition that's in effect year-round about water waste as well. So as I said before, outstanding response. Customers really get the severity of the drought. You can't live in California without understanding the state of affairs with this drought. It's true that some districts and portions of California, even down into the valley, have it a bit worse in terms of the water supply. But our customers understand this, and I feel they want to really make a difference. So as far as conservation progress goes, on a weekly basis, this is the last that I had available, our customers conserved 34% for the week of July 16th to the 22nd in comparison to 2013. And there's that 32% for June, and the year-to-date is 29%. So it's above our mandated 28%, but it's just been a really good result. This is another graph that shows the monthly comparison of 2015 versus 2013. As we go into July and August, you can see green is the 2015 year-to-date. Red is our goal, 2013 less 28%. So we're really on track. I've added a slide about recycled water. We also provide recycled water in the western portion of our service area. I've added it because, though it's not required, we've asked our recycled water customers also to meet the 28% cutback. And I'm happy to say they have, largely. As you can see, the 2015 year-to-date is more or less tracking the 2013 red line, the gold line. So, as a small purveyor and provider, relatively small, our service area is fairly significant, and the infrastructure needed to go through the our variable terrain is fairly complex. We've had a really good response, as you'll see in this slide. From June 2014 to April 2015, EID had led the 100 largest water districts according to the Sacramento Bee article. So that was when it was only a voluntary situation. This year it's mandatory, and as you could see previously, our customers really have they've exceeded our expectations. So. We feel like the messaging has really echoed this, and we've tried to give them the tools that we could to be able to make to achieve these conservation results. That's the end of my presentation. I thank you. I'm going to leave it here with Luis.
Thank you, Jesse, and welcome everybody. I'm so happy to be here as part of this presenting team and to present the information about our campaign, Sandy Against Waste No Water. But first, a little bit of background. San Diego imports up to 85% of its water from Northern California and the Colorado River, and we have two wholesalers that we get our water from. That's Metropolitan Water District for pretty much all of Southern California, and then the San Diego County Water Authority. City of San Diego's population is 1.3 million people, number of connections just under 280,000 connections total. We have 9 reservoirs, and our usage, 2004 usage, equates to about 137 gallons per capita per day, or more recently, as the state is tracking in terms of residential gallons per capita per day, that's 72 gallons per person. You've seen this slide before. This is the state of California's drought, and a lot of California is under severe, extreme, or exceptional drought. However, for this presentation, I chose to go back to the earlier drought that we have, which is 2009-2011. That way I can talk about the successes of the campaign as we went through an entire drought cycle. So that picture in 2009, slightly different, but still, if you can see in the state, we were under severe drought, most of it. And especially in San Diego, we were taking this seriously. As you know, we import up to 85% of our water. So our reduction target back in 2009 was a 15% reduction coming from the two wholesalers. San Diego has never implemented a drought-related mandatory water use restrictions back then. This would be the first time. We've implemented voluntary before. We've implemented a lot of programs, but this will be the first time that we would be doing mandatory restrictions. So we had to come up with messaging, and the key components that we had is, one, we need to increase the awareness to the need to conserve water. We are so far removed from our water sources, it's hard to let people know that this is where our water comes from. And we needed to educate them and needed to make sure that they understand the need to conserve water, and more especially, the urgency of the problem. The drought is getting to be more severe, and we needed to do something about it. And the third key item that we thought was necessary to be included in messages is not only do you frame the problem and the urgency of it, but you have to give them action items, things that you want them to do so that they can go ahead and help in terms of conserving water. And this is the slogan that we came up with back then, no time to waste, no water to waste. It's clear. It's time to change. So there's a lot of things that happened with the slogan, we had time. We were preparing people for mandatory restrictions. So you can see we said here mandatory water use restrictions start June 1st. So it's kind of like it is coming. It is coming soon, and be prepared. And so we wanted to have that information out in the public and in the community where the people are. So we attached our slogan and wrapped a trolley that pretty much ran through major corridors in San Diego. We timed the trolley, where the trolley runs, based on significant events around San Diego. So during football season, we made sure that the trolley wrap went through the line that goes through the Chargers Qualcomm Stadium, or during the summertime, the one that runs through or next to the Padres ballpark, Petco Park, and beach areas. We had buses wrapped as well to make sure that these moving billboards went through the community. And then one other thing that we did was we had an airplane banner. We flew over beach communities all weekends in July 2009. So you can just imagine a lot of people going to the beach for July 4th fireworks, or just enjoying the beach in general, or the county fair in Del Mar, where a lot of people attend. They were seeing these banners fly over. And we decided to use a lot of black and white, and if you notice that in our materials, because, again, we wanted to communicate the urgency of the situation. So we had ads on, aside from TV ads, we had ads on the newspapers. And you'll start to see this. We started with a little bit of a play. You'll see it here, and you'll see it in other slides that I'll have. The no time to waste, no water to waste, we have a different color for the middle words, because that is our action item, waste no water. And then so at times we would blur the black ones to highlight waste no water. And you'll see it in the succeeding ones. These are banners that we had throughout the community that pretty much tell us waste no water, fix leaks, water less. Those are the action items that we wanted. And this is an example of what I was talking about, a website ad where we would, there's animation, and within the animation we would blur the other word so that waste no water becomes highlighted. Again, we went to billboards, traditional billboards as well, and aside from just the regular type, we also tried to do some of these billboards with the fading letters. And not only in billboards, but in malls, in counters where there are customer service counters, where pretty much where people are every day. We wanted to make sure that our information is there. The thing about coming up with a campaign is, do you know what kind of response will you get? And this being the first time that San Diego is going to mandatory restrictions, when it came to campaign development, our mayor's office was really involved from the get-go in terms of just the concepts. We reviewed 10 different concepts and slogans. We wanted to make sure that the concept that we had, one, can show a transition to post-drought. After the drought, can we continue to use this? And as you can see, and you'll see later, this no time to waste, no water to waste will transition into San Diego's Waste No Water as the campaign that we use to address lifestyle changes, not so much drought impacts. We wanted a campaign that would show collective action. Again, San Diego's Waste No Water is something that shows that everybody's doing it, and that you are not alone in doing it, and collectively we can do something significant. And finally, campaign messages evolve from these meetings that we had. We had several meetings that ultimately came up with our slogan. We were lucky enough to have our mayor, who was very interested to be our campaign endorser back in 2009 to 2011, and the nice thing about that is that you get ample news coverage. You get a lot of TV cameras every time you have a press conference, and his staff pretty much wanted us to have a press conference every week to just to keep the information out there and the urgency and the awareness up. We were able to secure some media buys, key media buys, and that back then in 2009, City of San Diego, Waste No Water campaign was pretty much the only one campaign that we had, the only major campaign that we had in the San Diego market. The San Diego County Water Authority supported our campaign back then, so we were in control of the message in the San Diego market. With regards to funding, we, for the first fiscal year, we had about $750,000 budgeted for media buys. But we ended up not really using it. We tried to be flexible. As you can see, we put it in phases. Phase one was introducing the need to mandatory conservation, and then we targeted for phase two, summer, the hot summer months, and tried to put money into there, addressing specific media that we wanted to highlight. And then post-summer and into winter, and then finally as we end up the fiscal year. And we kept our expenditures flexible depending on how we are trending in terms of our reduction in usage throughout the year. When the drought was lifted back in 2011, one of the things we did is we thought that some of these restrictions that we had in place made sense to make it permanent. In fact, you know, why would excessive irrigation be lifted because the drought's over? Or why would we say it's okay to wash sidewalks and driveways because the drought is over? So we kept some of these restrictions as permanent restrictions in the city of San Diego. So, for example, no irrigation runoff, washing cars with a hose with a shut-off nozzle or a bucket. That was a permanent restriction in San Diego. Fixing leaks, of course. And no irrigation in the middle of the day. That became a permanent restriction. And then restaurants serving water upon request is also a permanent restriction. And so as we continued post-drought, we didn't really see a significant bounce back in usage because we had restrictions that remained in place that we continued to enforce, and it helped in terms of keeping the usage in San Diego lower, and it helped in terms of creating a lifestyle in San Diego. Now we go to the current drought. The current drought, Jesse was talking about their reduction target from the state. San Diego, City of San Diego's reduction target is 16%. Now, this 16% seems to be something that's really doable, but knowing that we had demand hardening because we kept enforcing restrictions from 2009, 16% was really a tough target to achieve. And so our plan, the initial plan, is to implement outreach and enforcement in terms of achieving this. But we needed to do something about our restrictions because we didn't think that our current restrictions the way they were, even though we go into drought response level 2, that it would be enough to achieve 16%. So we made some changes to our municipal code and specified that for drought response level 2, we were going down to 2 days a week watering with a maximum of 5 minutes runtime per station for non-standard, or this would be your fan-type sprinkler heads. If you had the more efficient heads, they were not limited in terms of runtime, but only for standard fan-type sprinklers that we had a 5-minute runtime maximum per day for in within 2 days a week of watering. So far, when we looked at June 2015 usage, our usage is 24% lower than it was back in 2013, and 2013 is the base year that the state is using for comparison and for evaluating our conservation efforts. And as you can see now, it became a little different from when it was stark and when it was urgent, a lot of black and white. When it became more of a lifestyle change, we changed the colors a little bit. San Diego's Waste No Water is a newer trolley wrap where it says San Diego's Waste No Water, always, always, and you'll see more of that in others here. getting the community involved, taking pictures in iconic places in San Diego or iconic events like Comic-Con, and showing the messaging is part of our plan on a regular outreach and keeping it, becoming it a way of life. So in this case, San Diego Waste No Water, conserve always, always. And when we say always, that now starts to lead into discussion of the different ways that we can conserve or reduce our potable consumption, and that includes potable reuse, that includes other projects that we're looking at, desal, it all blends in, and we're able to communicate those and co-promote programs. The fact sheet that we developed early on, again, using the colors that were more of the everyday colors. This is when we had 3 days a week for level two, and as I mentioned earlier, we changed that to 2 days a week. And if you notice, the black and white started coming back because we wanted to, again, communicate urgency, and we wanted, again, to make sure that people, it caught people's attention. So we were going back to more of the black and white colors for the campaign. And also, one thing I didn't have in the slide, but I saw from Jesse, in terms of enforcement, San Diego has a very active water waste reporting process. Customers can report water waste via telephone, phone call, go into our website, or we actually, one other way is we develop a smartphone app. Made it easy for customers as they are walking their dog, biking, they see water waste, somebody irrigating a wrong day, or there's runoff. Just take a picture of it. It automatically downloads the GPS location and tell us when it happened. It also timestamps everything so we know where it happened, when it happened, and that's all recorded. And the smartphone app works for us. We've got over 4,000 downloads for the app on both platforms, Android and iPhone platforms. And the app has the ability to, if you reported a water waste, that you can go back and check on the status of the report that you made. Early on for this drought, we engaged our community and made sure that our largest users were aware of what was happening when it came to the drought and what was happening in Sacramento, the announcements coming from Sacramento and how it related to San Diego. So we engaged a lot of the key industries in San Diego and keeping them informed of how we plan on achieving the reductions in, like I said, through outreach and enforcement and targeting pretty much ornamental landscapes with the 2x5. And so far, like I said, it's not easy to achieve the 16% because of demand hardening. This is a chart that shows monthly how we were trending compared to 2013. And for the most part, we were about the same. We would dip a little bit below 2013, or we would go a little over 2014. December was a significant reduction, December 2014, because we had a lot of rain. But when it started to count in terms of reductions and targets given by the state, you know, in May we had a 26% reduction, in June we had a 24% reduction. So this is a really good start for us and for San Diego. And this is a common sight now throughout California. If you are from California or if you come to visit us here in California, our freeways will have this sign that says Zero Drought, Help Save Water. The state is together in terms of communicating the message that there is a Zero Drought and we need everybody's help in making this work for us. At this point, I'm finished with my presentation, and I will be passing over the controls to Jeff for Denver Water.
Hey, thanks, Lewis and Jesse. Before him, I think that was great. I just learned a ton, and I was taking notes, so it caught me off guard that I'm up and ready to go here. Jeff Terrell from Denver Water, and I'll give you a brief like who we are and kind of where we're going. We're old, been around since 1918. We have over 1 million people, about 1.4 million customers, And we use, of the states, of all water used in the state of Colorado, we're only using 2% of that. So we're in the bigger picture, we're kind of small, but we're still a big fish when it comes down to what's going on in the municipal and industrial area. You look at the total watershed area, what we manage, it's about 4,000 square miles. It's big. Half of that is on the western slope, which is where half of our water comes from. The other half, of course, is the eastern slope, where the other half comes from. And I have a picture of one of our customer service field guys. And in the context of this discussion of communication during drought, there's no one more important than the person that's out there in the field. That anyone who's out there talking to a customer is probably the most important thing, and making sure that they have the talking points and that they know what we're doing internally is pretty near and dear to me, because we know that that matters a lot. So, you know, it's like, it's pretty important. And I'm going to give a presentation that's really going to go back 15 years, where Lewis went back to 2009. I'm going all the way back to 2000 to say where we were two droughts ago and how that has affected our conservation programs, how our conservation programs have changed over that time. And I'm going to orient you to this slide here because it's actually pretty important, and I'm going to bring it back up a few times. I have a box on the right here that's blocking out what happens up through 2014. I don't want to spoil it for you guys because, you know, I will show you these as these go. It's going to talk about our what our gallons per capita per day is, and we're talking about that all in, all like million plus people, every property, every park, every school. And it's important for us to think about, it's not just single family, it's not just commercial, it's everything going on when we're trying to manage water or manage a drought. And so you'll see this come back up again. And going back to the 2001-2000 time frame, we came into that with, you know, moderately lower reservoirs. Lake Dillon in July of 2002 was going down fast. And usually at that point you can still see some snow on the mountains in the background. Usually there's quite a bit more up in the Rocky Mountains at that point. And, you know, this may be, you know, a few years ago I would have had to explain that I'm actually looking towards the reservoir, but I think people have seen so many pictures just like this from California that you guys are getting what drought looks like and what it looked like back then. I think it was a really good and easy thing for us to talk about drought in 2002. We could show this picture of the marina from the Frisco Marina, and a lot of our customers knew this location, and it was pretty easy for them to go, wow, that's big. They could also drive right past on I-70 when going up to the mountains, and they could see, hey, Dillon's going down. It was a really good poster of what's happening to our lakes and streams. Out of that, we said, hey, we have to do something. We need to communicate drought. And I think just, you know, when you think about where we were at in 2002, we, as a Denver Water, a bunch of other municipalities, hadn't dealt with this severe of a drought in, you know, since the 1980s. The collective knowledge and the people that had worked on that were mostly gone. And we were kind of starting from scratch. There was no manual of what do we do, how do we get this done. And I think that, you know, from a conservation perspective, we did a really good job with not a lot of good information and not a lot of good coordination in those early days. One of the things that in the lower right-hand corner, you can see the July watering schedule, the even and odd stuff that Lewis was talking about. Well, we went with a circle, diamond, and square, and I can guarantee you there are no irrigation clocks that we knew of that could actually be set to this. I think we got a lot of savings because we just confused people. And, I mean, I was a water customer, and I didn't know what day my day was half the time because I was like, am I a circle? I'm a diamond, but what day is it today? What's going on? And so people, it was probably not the easiest way to communicate what we're doing. But I think it's also just, you know, to go through kind of the severity of what we were looking at that point and how we got caught, like not unaware. This slide really to me, told me a really big story of what happened in 2002. We always project forward where we're going to be with reservoir storage on July 1. It's a pretty good indicator of what that water year was like. Most of our runoff has occurred. Our reservoirs are generally near full at that point. Well, in April, we thought we're going to be about full, 87%. No reason to panic. Fast forward to May 1, it's looking more like 75%. By June, we were saying it's 66%, and we ended near, we got to about 60% on July 1st. So this was something, every time we did the projections forward, the snowpack had sublimated, had melted right off, gone into the soil, it was gone. So we were scrambling a lot faster. And it's hard to put out a good communications to your customers when you don't know what's going on and you can't communicate any of that kind of what's going to happen. This next slide, pull up what our residential rates were in 2000, 2001. You can see, started off $1.58, $1.90, $2.37, and these were pretty large buckets. I mean, you didn't get to $2.37 in the early 2000s until you hit 60,000 gallons. Well, we did some surcharges, and we ratcheted up quick. So if you were, a large irrigator or a large, had a large outdoor space, you really got hit in a hurry. Again, going back to that, this was happening fast. We pulled this out quickly. We slapped it on in July as the board said, hey, we're in drought. You need to make this happen. Pushed it out to our customers. For a customer that wasn't really paying attention or hadn't read through their bill thoroughly, this probably showed up for the first time for them as the actual what you owe. We certainly got some attention. We also did a lot of refunds of these surcharges because these were based upon just your actual use. Some of this, we had some other surcharges based upon percent increase for our larger customers, whether they were efficient or not. We just said we got to get reductions. And I think that out of that, we learned a lot of highly valuable lessons. Biggest one, I think, was expect controversy. Whatever you do, you're going to have winners and losers on this, and that having a surcharge during drought is probably a good thing. How big do you need to make it is probably is you need to understand how big do you need to make it to actually get people to react and make it so it's not so big that if somebody has a leak or has something else that they feel like they're being penalized and you kind of push them outside of what you want them to do. You want them to feel like they're working with you. So coming out of that drought, the surcharges, the kind of the penalties and everything else we did, we moved pretty drastically down from 2000, 2001. You can see that we got down to about 150 gallons per person per day by 2004, came back up slightly in 2005 as we moved out of the drought, and all of that reduction, that was our customers reacting. That was them doing it. We certainly led on a lot of that, but I still have to give big kudos to our customers of when we said you need to, jump and go, they did it. They really ratcheted down. And in 2005, our board looked at this, our demand planning, a lot of other staff, and even our rates people said, we can't keep doing it this way. Something needs to change. And we said, you know what, we need to start doing conservation and really ratchet it up that links back to our drought, what happened, and we set a goal, that dotted red line across there is a goal that the board set by 2016, we will get a 22% reduction. We will basically get back to where we were in 2003, 4, and 5, our average use during that time period, and that's 165 gallons per person per day. And we will get to that slide and show you where we're at on that. But kind of important to note, 22% reduction by 2016, quite the accelerated goal that our board put out for us. And we said we need to get out and engage customers. And in 2005, we went out and we started a campaign called Use Only What You Need. Very simple. It was really about what is the customer doing, kind of drawing attention to that you're going to use water. We know that. That's okay. But do it within what you actually need to get something done. And a lot of our other, it's like kind of tags that come out of that is like, replace your toilet. Don't have a leaking toilet. stop leaking toilets, change out your landscape. A lot of these things were able to be attached to this fairly simple tagline, and you can see that we used humor and sometimes shock and awe to get some attention. We would also educate on our best practices. We had a rule that, just like Lewis said, don't water in the middle of the day. Between 10 a.m. to 6 p.m., no watering. So you can see that the kinked hose, we don't have to say it. People should just know this because they've lived through, 5-6 years of this kind of restrictions. And by 2008, we were actually really using these billboards to communicate, beyond just humor, but also, hey, this is what you should or shouldn't be doing. And we also, 2009, we kept trying to be funny, and sometimes we hit the nail on the head, like the hose, the guy out there with the sign. Other times, we just made our partners mad. So if you're a landscape company, which when we go into drought, one of the groups we need to really work with is our green industry and others to say, hey, you've got to get this message out to your customers. And when the landscapers saw this, they said, it makes me feel like you're saying what I do and what I contribute to this is dumb. And that wasn't intended, but we always have to think about who's our audience and will we make our partners and our, the people that we need later on. If we make them mad with this, we should at least think about it. But humor is important. Also as important is that out of that 2006 22% reduction plan, it was not all about marketing. That would fall flat if you did not have the education and outreach. You didn't have a very robust rebate and incentive program. We have rebates for just about everything where water can be used and could become more efficient, from toilets, outdoor landscape, irrigation nozzles, you name it on that. We do a lot of commercial rebates, incentivizing from cooling towers, commercial washing machines, dishwashers, a whole bunch of different ways of getting that done. We also look at our rules. How do we enact rules that are going to get customers to move in the right direction, from new construction, installing sub-meters for any places that are multi-owner buildings, started that up in 2004, 2005. We also look at, how do we get rules for existing, remodels and other aspects. Narrow strips are a big thing. We don't allow for pop-up irrigation heads, overhead spray in 6 foot or less narrow strips. Something we'll probably continue to look at. Do we even make that less? Do we change even, you don't put turf into that? But we'll get there. And also near and dear to us is partnerships. We have to, work with our schools, our cities and counties. We're, the Denver service area is not just the city and county of Denver. We have Lakewood, Edgewater, Wheat Ridge, a bunch of other places. We need to communicate and work with those groups also, because they make decisions based upon what they know about what we're doing. And also our rates. Our rates should also reflect where we're going, what is using only what you need look like in your rate. And really glad to say that our finance people have just done a really big rate study, and we're going to be doing much more rates based upon actual use. And we're not quite to water budgets for all customers yet, but we're getting there. So I think that if you tune into future webinars where maybe Todd Cristiano's on, he will tell you our successes and failures and what we've learned from that. So through all of that, setting a new goal, a lot of outreach and communication through 2006 to 2009, you can see that we came back up slightly, but we came back down pretty dramatically in 2009. That was a very wet year. It's the first time we actually moved to monthly billing. So there's a lot of things that were changing around this same time. And right at that same time, we started moving back in towards drought. And this was, the point where 2010-11, we had good water years, but we still knew that, hey, this thing is looming out there. So we started looking at, all right, what are we going to do when the next drought hits? And lo and behold, 2012 and 2013 did not disappoint. By the end of 2012, we were really, looking worse off in our reservoir capacity than we had in 2002. Even with all of the conservation, the reduction in demand, that still didn't really address that issue that you have when you go into drought. But we were much further ahead of the game. We were actually looking and watching and monitoring the stuff so much closer than we had before that. And I think just, you know, look, this is a slide of what drought looks like as an internal bureaucrat at a water utility. It's not about what the reservoirs look like exactly. When that last slide I showed you, that's based upon snowpack and reservoir conditions that were still, you know, we'd done a better job. They looked more full. They were better off. They weren't draining as quickly because customers weren't using them as fast. But we also, you know, we created a new drought plan in 2011. That's the one on the left side. You can actually see this is my copy of it. It's dog-eared. It's got coffee stains on it. It's, you know, it got used. That thing didn't sit on the shelf for very long. And out of that, we actually started creating some of these, the 2013 drought documents. These were the things that actually led, you know, every one of these tabs in these books, every note in these moved from a plan, an internal planning meeting, to our board for approval, and then eventually out as a customer. You know, what is it that we're going to relay to the customer of what we know and what we're doing, whether that's about rates, water quality, the conservation message we're doing. All of that stuff really came out of these things, and that internal organization is incredibly important that you kind of capture this wisdom. And when we moved because of this, we said we're not going to just do use only what you need. We wanted to draw attention to that, you know, this thing is urgent, but we wanted to really connect back to, you know, the last 8 years or so of messaging that said use only what you need. We had orange on everything. We were used to being funny, but we got, much like Louis said, we got a lot more bold about it. We stripped away a lot of the text. We even moved from use only what you need to use even less. And you can see it's a very different feel. But we wanted to get some urgency, but we wanted to connect that to the past. We also changed that human dimension of it. When we're going out to, you know, the customer, that old adage of you can get more flies with honey, well, I don't think we were trying to attract flies, but we were trying to get people to actually really engage with us and have a conversation. We wanted the customer to not be afraid of us when we did water use enforcement. We wanted them to think, this is about water use education. Watering in the middle of the day, if you're doing that, that's not just bad for the water supply. That's not good for you. You're wasting water. A quarter of that's evaporating up off of the surface. You're not going to give it to the plants that you're hoping to. So that really, that change in perspective, I think, has done a great job. We issued very few fines. We didn't actually collect any money in our 2012-2013 drought, mostly because when I had a conversation, when it got escalated to my office, I could actually ask the customer, are you going to change what you're doing that got you here and not get a $50 fine? And I could go through, how could they change? Every one of them said yes. Every one of them that we knew of did it. So I think that's a positive story. Also out of that, we changed how we work with our larger customers. We realized that when we were moving into a severe drought, that trying to move to 2 or even 3 days a week for a customer that irrigates 3 to 5 to 20 acres of irrigated area, their system's not set up to get through that site in those couple of days or 3 days. So we introduced basically a volume allocation program or a water budget for these customers, saying what we're trying to get you to do is not reduce based upon your past usage, but let's reduce based upon a gallons per square foot. So if you've already done this work, much like what California has done, you're not going to be penalized more or less than somebody else. So we moved to 12 gallons per square foot and said, if you can stay there, you can stay in the program, as long as you're tracking along this bell curve of 12 gallons a square foot. If you go up beyond that, we're going to kick you out of it and say you're now under the days per week restriction, and you're not going to like that when it gets to June, July, and August. Most of our landscapers that I met with, community meetings I went to after, at the end of 2013, every one of them would hold up their water budget. Some of them, they'd put it up on a big poster and say, we're still at 25% less than we would have been normally. We use a quarter of what we would have in a normal year based upon the gallons per square foot. And that's a program we've actually continued. We've actually been growing this program and getting even more and more nuanced. The example in front of you is actually one of our customers. You can see, well, maybe you can see or not, it's quite small, but we have a map of the site. We show actual gallons used per month and the evapotranspiration of actual use. That's that green line of what we'd expect that customer to use. The orange line is historic, what we would expect if it was a normal, I don't know what a normal water year looks like anymore, but we've been rainy and cool this year. This customer here has mostly stayed below. They've bumped up in July. They've used a little bit more than the weather said, but they've stayed below for the most part. They're still on track to be within the weather, and we're hoping that this is going to work because we're not just sending this to one customer. We're sending it to the landscaper, the property owner, and the property manager, and the board. Everybody gets this information, because we want everyone to have the conversation. What's our goal? Where are we at? Are we getting there? So we've learned quite a bit of lessons since, you know, the 2002 and the 2013, and some of these things were pretty important that I touched on. The consistent baselines, sometimes we talk about percent reductions when what we really mean is gallons. And when we get to these discussions internally, it is important, and it really is something that we learned because we were talking about percentages. I was assuming, hey, we're talking about this many gallons from this type of customer. Another person was saying, oh, we were talking about just a percent off of 2010 usage. These things need to be really clear. Otherwise, you end up with different results, or at least, you know, not understanding, and your message gets lost to the customer. Did you want me to reduce this many gallons per square foot, this many days? What did you want me to do? Another lesson, we set up the incident command structure. I think if we'd done that earlier, we probably would have really worked through that baseline stuff, and I know that we will in the future, but pretty important that we talk about incident command, because this is, you know, like a fire, like something else, this is a natural disaster. It's slow moving, it might be here for a while, but it's good to have that structure in place, especially when you talk about communication. And we also know that we want to have a yearly water management plan. And so we walked into this year and last year with a meeting about where we at on water, who's going to do what is our baseline, and how do we move forward. Really good to get on the same page and to practice when you're not in drought. So out of all of this, this is where we're at as of last year on our gallons per capita per day. You can actually see since 2009, we've actually been below our 165 gallons per capita per day goal. We've actually been doing really well, but you can see 2 years of drought. 2012 was up near that goal. 2013 dropped quite a bit as we increased restrictions, and then we had a very big wet September, with even went to flooding, and 2014 was one of our wetter years on record until this year, which is probably going to even blow us away even more than this. But it shows this downward trend, and that, in my mind, it shows that our messaging, our programs, and our customers are all working towards getting this reduction. And one of our, you know, news stories that came out of this was, you know, we dipped to a 40-year low on indoor consumption. Our use 40 years ago, 1973, was actually about the same, even with 135,000 more customers. And we have really reduced our indoor demand drastically. Both single-family and multifamily customers have done this. And it's a cool news story to put that out. It also is going to help us as we move into drought, because we'll keep more water in our reservoirs. But as Louise said, you can't count on that reduction when you get to the next drought. So we're going to have to work on if we're expecting big demand reductions in the future from indoor, it probably won't happen as easily. So I'll leave you with the last couple thoughts here, that we're going to keep preparing for the next drought, and hopefully, before we get to the next drought, or as it comes to us, we're going to really be talking about communicating an efficiency level. What is, and that means it's like water budgets, either an informational one to a customer or based upon rates. It could be gallons per person per day indoors. It could be gallons per square foot outdoors. I think it's also looking at gallons per unit, maybe for multifamily where we don't have sub-metering and we don't know the number of people there. A lot can happen in that area, but we want to get to that efficiency level, because if we're going to tell people just a percent reduction, a lot of people will say, I've already done that, when I may want them to still say, hey, you're at 45 gallons per person per day, here's how you can get to 40 gallons per person per day indoor, or you're at 12 gallons per square foot, we're really shooting for 7, 7.5, and here's what we could get to. Those kind of things are just a different management levers that we're going to have. And that's all about that managing to the individual and not to the average. I can't say enough that we're going to have so many more new, better tools about how do we manage, whether that's GIS layers of what's the actual irrigated area, customer portals that actually people will tell us how many people live at the household. Those kind of things are coming to us. And I really want to embrace these new technologies of AMI, water sense technology that are coming out, better toilets, irrigation controllers, because those are going to really help us manage that next drought and be tools that our customers can use. And then the last part is really, it's moving from just thinking about large customers like schools and parks and breweries to think of them as not just a large user, but as a influencer. These are places where people go and they will get a message from that group. And if it's your church and your church is talking about how they've become water efficient and where they're at in their gallons per parishioner, gallons per square foot, don't know what that looks like right now. Parks doing the same thing. Schools, we've been doing a great job on figuring out the gallons per student per day and helping them get to that baseline. Those groups are going to translate what they did, how they got there, to everybody else, and it's going to, I hope, set us up to be, you know, a much better prepared for that next drought. And with that, I'm going to kick it back over to John and to others for questions.
All right. Thank you very much, Jesse, Luis, and Jeff, for your talk and all the lessons you learned and what you brought forward to the audience. So thank you. And we're on to our question and answer period. For the audience, we'd like to, you can submit a question at the lower half of your screen, and we'll try to get to as many as you can before we end this webcast. So we've gotten a few questions regarding the use of social media. And so I'll start with Jesse. Did you use social media within your program? You touched upon it briefly.
Yeah, we sure did. I'd be pleased to talk about that a little bit. You know, after hearing Luis and Jeff's presentations, it really is clear to me the scale of and difference of what we're approaching. Our social media has really only been a Facebook page, but we've been really aided by a Facebook group, and let me explain that a little bit. Our Facebook page maybe has 350, 360 likes on it, okay? Your average, social media user isn't going to like their local water purveyor's drought page, and we do our very best to get that information out there that they will. But again, after a year or so, there's only been about 350 folks who have signed on. What really has helped us is a Facebook group in our community, which reaches nearly 20,000 people. So when I post something to our Facebook drought page, here's a reminder. Oh, it's raining. It rained at this point. Remember, turn off your irrigation and for the 48 hours following. And if I just left that on our page, we'd get X number of views of that. Really, less than 100. When I cross post that to the Facebook group with that wider and more active constituency. I've had as many as 10,000, folks who have at least been exposed to it. Now, I understand Facebook has, that's not a one-for-one thing, but it's geometrical, really, the number of people who are actually seeing it when I get it to a larger audience. And this is an issue for us. We're in a small area. We're headquartered in a small town. A lot of our service area is rural, so it's helped us, but it's nothing that we rely on. It's just another channel that we do our very best to make use as powerfully as we can.
Great, thank you, Louise.
Yes, for San Diego, we back in the first draw that I talked about, we use a lot of Facebook and Facebook ads. Ads are there on the banner or on the margin on the side, and if we get any clicks, it brings it to our website, which is the Waste No Water website. And it was reasonable. It was $1 a click, and we had a certain budget per month, but it drove a lot of people to our website based on those Facebook ads that we had. We also had a Facebook page for Waste No Water, and we had followership, and we definitely wanted to increase that followership. So throughout the years, and even with this drought, what we've been doing is, in terms of trying to increase that followership, we did several things. So first of all, we have a film contest. It's a contest for high school and college kids to create a 30-second PSA, public service announcement video, usually themed around water conservation and the drought. And while we have judges who are from the industry, film and media industry, we select the winner based off of technical abilities and achievements. We also have a category called Viewer's Choice. And we open up our Facebook page to anybody who would like to vote online for their favorite videos. And usually the kids who submitted videos and their friends, they all started voting, and then they pass it on to their friends who will start voting, and then all of a sudden we notice that our followership is increasing. So that's one way that we were able to do that. And then we have also what we created for this drought, we call Watermarks Videos. San Diego, when we transitioned from no time to waste, no water to waste, to our current theme, which is San Diegans Waste No Water, pretty much is an affirmation that, one, you guys did a good job, San Diegans, we've been conserving water. San Diegans really waste no water. That's an affirmation. Two, it tells you that you're not alone, that you as a community are conserving water. So your efforts by yourself, you're not alone in doing that. Yes, San Diegans are doing it. So Watermark Videos pretty much now feature, your regular San Diegan, whether it's somebody in the community, somebody in the university, somebody in a local organization, or a known San Diegan. We have videos of them saying, this is how I conserve water, and then explain what they do to conserve water, and then challenge pretty much the people who view the video and say, make your mark, make sure you waste no water, and then hopefully that keeps forwarded on and on, and it was a good series, so we enjoyed having to promote and in terms of using that medium. The last thing that we started doing, the last significant thing that we did, was we approached Nextdoor.com. Nextdoor.com is kind of like a bulletin for communities, so specific areas in a community, and it's a way for them to get messages about their community. Usually it's safety messages, but then they open it up to water issues because of the drought. So we have been using Nextdoor.com to post information, whether it's going to be raining, make sure you turn off your sprinklers, or any kind of important information that we need to put out there. You guys are doing well, conserving water. Thank you very much. It's a new tool that we have, but it's also something that I think that it is very receptive because it's a new audience. And these are just examples of how we use the social media in terms of promoting our message. John?
Thank you. And to you, Jeff.
Yeah, I'll just wrap it up and say it's, I think social media, I probably skipped over it much too quickly. It is a big thing we do now. Certainly didn't do it way back in the day when it did not exist, but it's really a tool to further our message, whatever that message is. During the last drought, we created a drought blog, and that would allow us to provide real-time updates and to give stories about what's going on, what's happening, good stories, you know, like people are changing out their landscape, or this person, you know, did this thing and it worked very well, or, you know, not so good stories like, hey, we had a giant leak that spilled over, like, onto I-25 and shut down traffic. Here's why it happened. Here's how quickly reacted. Here's how many gallons. So it's like we were able to do that, and then getting that stuff out to other channels to link to it, like such as Twitter, even to our own website. We have not done a Facebook page, and I think that's mostly just because we don't have staff and we have not set up the Friends of Denver Water yet, but that's a good idea, and I hope to steal that one. Thanks.
All right, thank you all. And so now we've gone from social media, and we got a question in on the use of traditional billboards. A couple of you had mentioned the use of billboards, Luis and Jeff. I'll start with Jeff. Have you found the use of traditional billboards effective?
I would say they're effective, but I think that they have to be, you cannot just put up a billboard and say you're done. You want to reuse that material wherever it's at multiple times. Use it on your website, even pictures of that, because you're only going to get so many impressions or so many people driving by seeing it a day. You're not going to get it pushed out to everybody else, but that size and scale and location of that billboard, it can still be captured in a picture. It can still make it into a local newspaper, into other places. And so I think it's not just the billboard by itself. You really got to leverage what you say and how you get that out, you know, Twitters, all those places. You want to make sure that you're really maximizing that one spot or for the 2 months you have it.
Great, thanks. And Louise?
I think there's really a place for billboards, traditional billboards, because they're usually very visible. You probably don't want to put a lot of text on billboard because most of the people who are reading it are driving, and you have a certain number of seconds that there's that exposure to a billboard. So you want something that's catchy, but also something that gets your message across quickly. But if you're doing billboards, I would suggest look into movable billboards, which is what we did with trolley wraps and bus wraps. It's a billboard, but it goes through the community in different areas, so you have more exposure. And if you're going to do billboards, try and see if you can do partnerships with the billboard company. So we solicited and signed them up as a partner, and by doing so, we pretty much are able to put up our billboards, and we just pay for the materials and putting it up there, but not the rent part. The thing is with billboards also, it's usually just a month or whatever the term is, because there's a lot of requests for billboard space. So whatever you sign up for is probably what you get. But say, for example, with a trolley wrap or a bus wrap, if it still looks good and there's nobody else wanting to do a bus wrap, it probably will remain there for a longer period of time. So you get better value for the money that you spend.
Perfect. Thank you. And a question for you, Jesse. You mentioned the use of movie trailers. Can you briefly tell us how you use those?
Yeah, we use movie trailers really at the beginning, and we're not using them again this year. But we developed with the company that we selected a short message that basically talked about the watering restrictions. The idea was just to give folks, another way to see what was going on as they're waiting for their film to start. And we selected to make sure that it was as close to the feature as possible. But we don't have a real measurable way to find out if that really helped anyone. I had some anecdotal responses, and that's kind of informed our reasoning for not engaging it again. you know, it's you do what you need to do to meet your targets. You do what you need to do that will be most effective. And there are things that are super effective for a larger urban area. There are things that may not be quite as effective for the type of the community that you're in. For us, it wasn't as important. We wanted to hit everything. We tried a whole array of channels at the beginning because we really wanted everybody to be thinking about it, and to be able to see it everywhere. We felt was a good investment.
Great, thank you. And here's a question from a wholesaler. Do you have any suggestions for a wholesaler that don't have direct customers? And I know all three of you have direct customers, but I believe Luis and Jeff, you do have some consecutive systems. And how does your messaging work for them? I'll start with Jeff.
John, I can answer that. This is Luis.
Okay, perfect. Go ahead, Luis.
Okay, so City San Diego, while it's primarily a retailer, we're also a wholesaler to Cal American here in Coronado and Imperial Beach. So we act as a wholesaler as well. And what we do is we offer our programs, what we would offer normally City San Diego, to the customers of the retailer that we have. So we would say, for example, the film contest, the poster contest, or we make sure that we invite all those kids from those agencies as well. I guess as a wholesaler, you can help retailers in terms of whatever they do, in terms of programs, contests, if you could do more like regional coordination. County Water Authority does a lot of regional coordination and administration of programs, especially for smaller agencies that don't have all the staff that, say, for example, compared to the City of San Diego that we may have, that they do a lot of regional coordination and administration. And that way you have consistency in message, you have consistency in programs, and there's not a whole lot of confusion within the service area. And I think, at least in California, wholesalers are required to help the retailers as a best management practice to help reduce their usage through programs and assistance and resources.
Great. Thank you, Luis. And I see Jeff has just had to log off. So I would like to ask both Jesse and Luis our last question before we end this webcast. Will we continue to see a downward trend in water use in the future based upon these droughts that we've been having? And I'll start with Jesse.
Yes, I feel like we will. I'm just looking at our numbers, and I don't have all of those in front of me, but our customers over the past 5 years at least have been reducing their water usage. And I think as we have drought events like this, as it becomes a little bit closer to everybody's daily life, I think folks will be more cognizant of how they're using water, what they're doing with it. So I suspect that we'll continue. We'll continue this.
And Luis.
Well, my answer would be I hope so. I hope that this continues in terms of making sure that the reductions that we see continue, so that we can meet our state mandated goals. I think we will, because the message is out there. Everybody's communicating it, whether it's the state and Save Our Water campaign, or whether it's the wholesalers' campaigns that are present in our market here in San Diego, or the City of San Diego's messages. All of these help in terms of generating awareness and the urgency of the issue. I know that there have been some polls recently, and within those polls, it's showing that a lot of Californians are really in tune with what's happening with the drought, and some of them are actually willing to pay a little bit more in terms of their water bills, based on one poll that I saw, just so that we can continue to be able to weather the drought. The thing is, though, in San Diego's case, I know that when we had the first drought and we kept our usage fairly low as we entered into the second drought. What we're asking right now in terms of 2 days a week, 5 minutes runtime per station is causing a lot of brown grasses. And up and down the state, you'll see some brown grasses. So if the drought were to go away, will we see a spike in usage? Will people go back to putting grass or replacing their dead grass? We're hoping that with education and with programs such as incentives, that we can offer them choices when they do make those decisions, offer them smarter choices of what they can do to replace their turf. And then hopefully if those programs are successful, then maybe we won't see such a big kickback in usage when the situation is alleviated.
Yes, thank you very much. And so with that, I really want to thank Jesse, Louise, and Jeff for presenting such great case studies of their programs, highlighting what barriers they went through and some really great lessons learned to implement in their current programs. So thank you very much for presenting to us.
It was a pleasure.
I want to highlight to the audience, there is a survey at the end of this webcast, and we appreciate it if you could take it. It really helps the Water Research Foundation continue to give you the resources that you need. So I just want to highlight that. And also want to highlight that this webcast, along with all our other webcasts, will be archived on the WRF website. So with that, I want to thank everybody for attending, and again, thank our three great speakers, and we look forward to seeing you at our next webcast. Thank you.